Well, welcome, everybody. Thank you. I'm John Glosso, the chair of the Library Commission. And I'd like to acknowledge our city council person, Kathy Murillo, who reps for the city council to the commission and to the library. So I think we'll get started. But first, a couple of opening remarks. I want to congratulate and welcome Jessica, our new library director. It was a long and complete, thorough interview process, and we're really happy to have you. It's been a big year for the library. I hope you've all had a chance to go down to that children's library. That is absolutely spectacular, and the use it's getting confirms our decision to do that, I think, really well. It's beautiful. So congratulations to you, Gwen. You. The other thing that we've done is started to complete the remodel of the main floor. If you get another chance to go in and see the new entrance and the glass to the courthouse and the market space and the repainting and the carpeting, it's all looking really good. Thank you for doing that. Appreciate that. And we'll get into this a little bit more, but we have finalized the plaza redesign documents, and we're ready to go, and we're going to initiate phase one, which is the ADA compliance for the back side here between that garage and this back door. So there's a lot going on here at the library beyond the programming that is so successful, and that's very exciting, and we're really happy it's happening. In addition, we've started a strategic plan for the library writ large for everybody, which will be really helpful for the foundation that helps raise the money for the children's library, for example, and the Friends of the Library as well as the commission. With some kind of strategic plan, we can figure out how we can help support the library. And I want to commend all the staff for what they do. They don't probably get enough recognition. They work really hard, and they put on a lot of programs. If I'm not mistaken, the statistic I saw was we have more visitors than the Oakland City Library at Santa Barbara because of these programs and what we're doing for the community, and that's pretty cool. That's a good statistic, I think. And with that, I think we'll get on with the meeting. Can I have a call to order? I call it to order. roll call.
Lisette Naylor.
Present.
Christine Roberts.
Present.
Will Tomlinson.
Here.
Jonathan Glasso.
Here.
Milt Hess.
Here.
Here.
Thank you. Can I get a motion for the minutes?
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Discussion? Hearing none. Passes. Any changes to the agenda? We're good to go. Public comment. We have one public comment from Pete DiBello.
There we go. Thank you, Chairman, and library staff, and Councilwoman Murillo. My name is Pete DiBello, and I'm a Santa Barbara native, and I want to compliment the library on its good work. And as I mentioned earlier to several people, that I'm forever thankful to my mother and grandmother for always taking me to the library and instilling the importance of learning, and which I continue to this day. And it's always exciting to me whenever I see young children at the library, because hopefully they can follow, I guess you say, my example, in other words, even though they don't know me, but to know that they're on the right path to learning and to a better future. And as I've mentioned to people, that life is filled with so many questions, but most of the answers can be found at the library. And I want to thank the library for their good work and continued success. And I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, new business. Remarks from the chair we've had. So thank you very much. Director's State of the Library report and presentation.
Well, welcome, everyone. It's so wonderful to see all of you out tonight for the State of the Library. I think this is a great turnout. Very pleased. My name is Jessica Kediente, and I am the library director for the Santa Barbara Public Library System. And tonight, joining me will be senior librarians Gwen Waggy and Christina Hernandez, and from the Eastside Library, Marvel Zambrano Esparza. We are so excited to come here tonight to share with you the exciting things we're doing for our community. So first, I want you all to hold up your library card. If you have a library card, you know that the library is with you wherever you are. This gives you 24/7 access to streaming movies, digital magazines, ebooks, audiobooks. You can learn a language from home, study for your GED, GRE, SAT, and so much more. This card gives you access to over 1 million items in black gold. Well, our story tonight is going to be more about how libraries are transforming and are so much more than just what we lend. Traditionally, books and building were king. Interactions with our customers were transactional. Our library is evolving into a platform for learning, innovation, and creativity. Tonight, you will hear about our user-centered approach to innovation at Santa Barbara Public Library. So let's begin. Tonight's presentation will include the areas shown on the slide. And we will begin with the library overview. The Santa Barbara Public Library System is transforming the roles of the library to meet the new demands for service. The culture of learning and information access is moving very, very quickly, and we need job descriptions that are flexible and can respond to the ever-changing needs of our community. The two top positions, the strategist and manager of innovation and the user experience manager, have been created to help us to tap into these new resources to meet these new demands. Our goal at the library is to shatter the organizational paradigm and invite and nurture innovation. You will hear a lot about efficiencies and automation tonight because we want to pay people for their intellect. We want to reduce the amount of time spent on backroom efficiencies. We want to put our people's passions to work. But I know you're all expecting to hear some numbers, so we'll start with some traditional numbers. So here you can see that we have over 1.2 million people walk into our libraries every year, and we check out over 1.6 million items. But does this define a quality experience? The traditional way of looking at how the library delivers quality service to the community has changed. If our understanding of the library's value is based solely on getting information in a traditional or digital platform, then the long-term health of our library is at risk. Our vision must be grounded in the community's priorities. We are shifting our vision of our library to a platform of innovation. We want to expand opportunities for people to pursue curiosity, collaboration, and experiment. Our collections are performing. As Chair Glasso said, the Children's Library has been very successful. This last fiscal year that we're currently in has almost reached the totals of last year, showing that creating that space has allowed for the children in our community to find a home at the library. Adult AV is obviously outperforming all other materials. It is the dark gray there. But what we need to really look at is that our ebook and our digital platforms continue to grow aggressively. And this data helps us shift how we change our funding to meet the demands of the user. Again, so this represents the last 8 months of community education and programming for the library. Again, these numbers are very impressive. 4,600 early literacy participants, 182 community education programs, over 1,000 total programs and classes in just the last 8 months. But how do these numbers tell our story? Does this tell you how many more kids are reading at home, or if parents are reading to their children more? Do you understand the community and collective impact that our library has by looking at these numbers. We're here tonight to do a better job telling our story. So we are breaking traditions. Today's library is continually changing to meet the demands of our community. They are no longer quiet. They are no longer books only. We are no longer passive. You do not have to just come to the library to use and benefit from us. The library is anywhere you are. We are going beyond the book because everyone has access, thanks to the invention of the smartphone. Information is everywhere. We're overloaded. Our role at the library has shifted from gatekeeper to guide. Staff roles are changing, customer roles are changing, and we are going beyond the book. So we look to organizations such as the Aspen Institute to help guide us as we are reinventing and looking forward. Forming communities and collaboration is the core of what libraries do. We are working to create a library that is equipped to handle 21st century community issues. Extraordinary libraries create extraordinary communities. With this in mind, 6 months ago, we sat down with the staff and we talked a lot about the mission of our library and the vision of our library. Why do we love our jobs? What do we offer our community? What are our values? How do we help create the future of our community? And this discussion led us to what we are calling Santa Barbara Inspires. It is our new service model, and four principles guide this model. First, customer first. All staff is cross-trained for seamless public service delivery. We want to deliver customer service consistency. We are changing old policies and procedures to allow patrons to get help from the first person they encounter. We are focused on the customer. We are examining how all of our functions could be turned from staff-centric to customer-controlled. We are moving from transactional to relational. Most importantly, we want to give them what they want. Thank you. We are listening to the customer in the building, outside of the building. We want to meet their needs. Second, we want to teach customers. We are reducing behind-the-scenes work so that our staff can be where the customers need them, either in the building or in the community. We are increasing that face-to-face time. Any staff member can give a basic orientation, can teach the customers how to use our library. Bottom line, we are engaging more, and we are relationship building. Third, we recognize that we need to innovate our environments. Our physical space must undergo a transition that embraces the openness and flexibility needed to thrive in a world of constant change. Central to this flexibility is creating spaces that can adapt to the changing operations of our libraries. And the reduction of physical materials and the greater customer mobility and the desire to collaborate and to create in this public space of the library has transformed the way we are looking at our spaces. And fourth, and most important to me, is enabling staff. We recognize that we must enable staff to do their jobs. So to help set clear guidelines and to empower staff, we developed in-house training tools. We have successfully launched our Library Academy, which is an online learning module created by staff. And librarians teach classes to other staff on everything from digital content to reader's advisory. We are committed to setting our staff up for success. So if the traditional numbers that we look at aren't the way we want to measure success, what does success look like in this new library? Community impact. Are we participating in the collective impact of our community? Are we sustaining healthy, resilient communities? Customer satisfaction, are we giving you what you want? Do we have a seat at the table? When policymakers are discussing community initiatives, is the library at the table? culture of continuous improvement. Are we always looking for ways to improve ourselves, our library, our community? And we have success stories. We have over 87 active partnerships. We are increasing access to materials in multiple formats. We're increasing staff to be available for our customers. And we have specifically designed programs to target specific needs. And an example of that specially designed program is our new Baby and Me story time.
We're at the Central Library. I am a lion! Roar. We're having it every Wednesday at 12:30 in the afternoon.
It's really great, and it's the perfect time of day for me, because otherwise you just use adults all day and all the time.
It's really very much a library activity in that it promotes early literacy. It's designed to help parents learn how to engage better with their children in terms of offering them the songs, the rhymes that are going to help babies get ready to read and to love literature on their own.
We love that there's other kids here of all different ages. It was fun. There was dancing. Her favorite part was the parachute going in and out of it.
Good successful way to introduce music and introduce other kids.
Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream.
A chance for us all to be together as a community for new mothers, new fathers.
Here in Santa Barbara, there is a great need for programs with you and your baby, but there's not a lot of programs that are free. And what's great about the public library is we offer that program, and it's at no cost, and you get a chance to do something fun with your baby.
Well, it's fantastic that the library has these free programs, because and then you can meet all these other parents.
It's good for Ellie to socialize and meet other babies, and yeah, it's just a lot of fun. It's also a good break for the day to get out of the house for a little bit. So, yeah, it's a great program.
It's by the program. I like it.
Mommy's on the bus, say I love you.
For more information, you can always contact the children's desk at the Central Library. Our number here is 805-564-5603.
I love these programs so much.
Time, won't you sing with me?
I love the library.
And a special thanks to Larry Nimmer for shooting that video. If that's not the cutest thing you've ever seen. But of course, we couldn't do so much of what we do without our tremendous volunteers, from the foundation to the friends to all of our volunteers that show up every day. Over 25,000 hours were donated in time to the library last year, and we just want to say thank you. Now we're going to move on to the budget presentation. And so the library department has two funds, a general fund, which is the city libraries, and then the county fund. This presentation will focus on the city libraries. But this is an overall snapshot of the entire library department at $7.77 million. And you can see the split between the two funds. So these slides were in your packets. This represents all of the funds. I don't want to spend too much time on those and actually just get to the city library funds. Okay. So this is the second year of a two-year budget, so there really isn't that much to report, no major changes. Our revenues were down slightly this year, due to reduced donations and grants. And a quick snapshot of our grants. We currently have four. The Homework Help Grant will be phased out next fiscal year, and the Read Together Grant will be phased out completely in 2019. But during the course of these grants, we have identified that they have presented us with core services that we feel are essential to the library. Therefore, we will be absorbing these positions created as part of these grants into our budget. And then this slide represents the appropriations or expenditures and what our money goes towards. 69% of our budget goes towards staffing costs, and this aligns with our belief that our staff are our biggest assets. And we are actively reinventing and updating job descriptions to allow our staff to be the local heroes that we know they all are. And again, this is just the expenditures in spreadsheet format. And along with the budget, we plan and identify key performance measures and objectives that we want to complete in the upcoming fiscal year. And tonight, we selected five to highlight. The first is the strategic plan that Chair Glasso mentioned. The Santa Barbara Public Library strategic plan will provide a cohesive vision and direction for our library for the next 5 years. The plan will outline the library's strategic direction for customer-focused service, 21st century facilities, and enhanced technologies to better serve our community. Libraries are on the cusp of a great transformation. People are changing the way they access information. Our interactions with one another are changing. The tools we need to be successful in today's society have changed. The library is responding to those changes. We are evolving, and the strategic plan is intended to provide vision and direction as the Santa Barbara Public Library adapts thoughtfully and boldly to emerging challenges and opportunities for the benefit of our community. Next, we have an initiative called Innovate at SBPL. One of our key values at Santa Barbara is that we are a culture of innovation and continuous learning. And to help foster this culture, staff need a process to push their creative ideas forward. Innovate at SBPL earmarks funds that will allow staff to apply for small grants, and the intent is to empower them and to recognize and implement their creative ideas. We want to spark creativity and give a path for it to move forward so that staff can have an idea and see it actualized. Again, we're always listening to our community, and we've had many comments about the need for new and expanded programming for the 50-plus age group. And again, the strategic plan will help us identify how to truly move this initiative forward. Teen services and space. We have an amazing new children's library that has served the needs of the children in our community under the age of 12 beautifully. But I admit that when my 13-year-old son came and saw it, he says, "Mom, this is great, but where do I go?" And when I had to point to the upstairs second floor and the teen space up there, he felt a little left out. So we're excited to be talking about how we can expand those services. And we'll be bringing teens in and getting their input on how to move forward with the space and with the services. And lastly, we're looking to remodel workspaces. The majority of our staff work in the basement. And for some reason, they call it the dungeon. I know it's just a playful nickname, but it hasn't been renovated in decades, and the lighting is poor, and so I am very excited to start planning improvements that will help them work more efficiently and more collaboratively. Capital projects as part of this year's upcoming budget. The main level continues to transform. People are amazed by what has already happened. If you come in 6 months from now, a year from now, you'll continue to be amazed because we have more and more plans for this main level. Automated materials handling. So this is an image of our current check-in. It's very staff intensive. This is what is coming this year. And the whole point of this, again, is to redeploy staff to value-added tasks. And touching on the backroom efficiencies again, the remodel of that basement will be a major capital project. But you see the need for going digital and creating collaborative spaces, improved lighting. We get many comments about the lighting throughout the library. And so we are very happy that over the next 6 months, all of the lighting on the main floor and second floor will be tremendously improved. I wish I had a picture of the gentleman who comes in with a headlamp to browse. Okay. And again, as Chair Glasso mentioned, the south side ADA access. This is the current design. There is no access to the south side entrance, which is the parking lot entrance. We often see people, when I say no access, I mean no ADA access or ramp. So that means strollers, wheelchairs, walkers, people with any disability need to walk all the way around our building right now. So this is the before and the after. So we have this lovely designed ramp that will increase the access to our library. And construction is set to begin early fall. The restoration project. This is the project that will repaint the building as well as address any structural issues. And it couldn't come at a better time because in 2017, the library building is due to celebrate its 100th anniversary. And this is a rendering that was presented to Historic Landmarks Commission for the new paint colors. So it will be three different shades of brown. So as again, we have completed designs for the entire plaza project. So the ADA access is just phase one of that project. And the former library director, Macias, worked for years to get this final design completed. And we will be working with our foundation to determine funding possibilities. This project is so important because it will help us move beyond our walls. We are the cultural hub of Santa Barbara, and the new plaza design is vibrant and will help engage our community. It will encourage and foster collaboration outside of our walls. And the east side will be getting a renovated community room as well. Their MLK room will get new flooring, new kitchen, AV equipment, long overdue as well. So we're very excited about that. And now I would like to introduce Senior Librarian Christina Hernandez. She will go into more detail on some of the things that I have highlighted.
Thank you. $1,210,917. Do you know this number? This is the number of patrons who came through our doors last year, and this year we are already over 812,000. Why do they come in, and why do they keep coming back? The art of self-service. Library users, they want to be independent. They want choice, convenience, comfort, and customer service. To meet this goal, we offer online card registrations. There are no more paper applications. We offer make your own PC reservations and holds. 91% of holds are actually placed by the user themselves. Checkout. Our machines not only check out to you, but allow you to manage your account as well, all on your own. And in fact, 80% of all checkouts are done through the self-check machines. And we are even trying to increase that number. Returns. We're taking returns one step further, as Jessica mentioned, with the coming of the automated materials handling. Users will be able to check out on their own and get a receipt. And the machine will then sort the items for staff. Studies show that self-service is the preferred service. It also enables staff to move to where the value-added tasks are, such as programming, teaching, and being out in the community. They're coming in for services on demand. The library has a new mobile app. It allows you to search the catalog, access your account, renew, find out about events at any library branch, and locate material. Auto renewal. 2 days before your items are due, they will automatically be renewed without any action from the patron. Very convenient. Downloads and streaming featuring ebooks, online movies, language learning, business information, test preparation, and much, much more. And all of this is available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And right now, we're even trying to expand our services on demand through virtual reference and reserving a librarian. They're coming in for changing library spaces. This is not the old style library. We are redesigning spaces so patrons can be more self-directed. There'll be a new community board and magazine areas coming soon that are more organized. People are coming in for group study and group projects. They're using our new designated eating and drinking area. There's free entertainment. Our library is busy, it's vibrant, and we are coming to you. Library space is no longer just this building. It's community education is now a major initiative here, and all staff are being trained to go out into the community and bring services directly to you. Trends impacting some of our operations: the print versus digital, and the increase of ebooks and e-resource use. And everything has gone mobile with pocket technology. Many people forget to carry their library cards, but everyone always has their cell phone with them. And with the library app, that means that you always have the library with you wherever you are. Mobile staff. Staff are now able to use technology to help people from any point in the library or even outside of the library in the community. And again, 24/7 access and on-demand services. The library is no longer just a place or just a building, but a hub of community. It is where people seek connectivity, collaboration, and technology. Another trend is changing demand on library spaces. The group study, eating, and varying noise levels in the library. We are no longer this quiet library. And the library is the great equalizer. It's one of the last places you can go where all of these services and programs are truly free. And to demonstrate just one of the trends, you can see print collections holding steady over the last couple years and then declining while ebooks are on the rise. At this point in the year, we have already passed 69,000 ebook checkouts. It's very close to the final number at the completion of last year. And based on these trends, we have to reconfigure our policies and our procedures. We want to improve customer satisfaction, so we allow the ability for patrons to suggest a purchase. We also have completed a collection survey. We want to increase customer access. The library recently developed a foster family card that makes it easier for foster children in the community to have continuous access throughout their youth. We also make cards outside of the library during community events. We strive to reduce processing time for materials. This leads to faster turnaround time, making more materials available to you. And we cut out processes that don't add value, which frees up staff to put their passions to work and do more meaningful work out in the community. And we are providing new guidelines for staff engagement. Patrons are coming in for the programs. We just completed Santa Barbara Reads with Just Mercy by Brian Stevenson, with the aim of one book, one community, thousands of conversations. In 2015, with Santa Barbara Reads, we had 4 discussion panels system-wide. This year, we had 17 programs. Also, as part of Santa Barbara Reads, we had a solitary confinement cell exhibit right here in our lobby for 1 week. You can see the photograph in the middle. The exhibit sparked 458 conversations with our volunteers in 1 week. We had a successful Food for Finds program. This allowed us to build a new partnership and it enabled customers to give back and build up our community food banks. And coming soon, we have much more. We have Music Academy of the West Fellows Concert Series coming, and Friday Afternoon Film Series. And we have the expansion of our Imagination Station. It's our interactive space in the library where all ages can play and learn. We have three 3D printers, new digital equipment featuring laptops, a flat screen TV, iPads, and a smart podium. We have a DJ station, open maker space where you can design and print in 3D. We have technology classes. Take it apart Tuesdays. Kids are no longer getting in trouble for taking things apart. We encourage it here at the library. And coming soon, Crafternoons, with a variety of creative craft-making sessions at noon. The library is now the place where you can take the risk. You can come in and touch the technology before you buy. I'd now like to introduce Maribel Zambrano Esparza from our Eastside Library to share exciting things happening at Eastside.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Maribel Zambrano Esparza. I am the supervisor at the Eastside Library. I have a little bit of information and some facts to share with you about our wonderful programs at the Eastside Library. Already this fiscal year, at our little library on the other side of town, we have had over 71,000 people come through our door. Last fiscal year, for the entire year, we had over 109,000 visitors. So our summer reading program that we do every year, in 2015, we had over 700 children sign up for our summer reading program. And a wonderful task, we think it's a big milestone for us, over 50 teens signed up for our summer reading program. Our early literacy classes and attendance is already close to 1,200 for this year. Last fiscal year, we had nearly 5,900. We've had 250 children participate in our Summer Reading Buddies program that we do. In 2015, we had 250. In 2014, we had 197. This has been a wonderful program where we pair older children from our surrounding programs, such as Fun in the Sun, and they read to our younger preschoolers that we pair with our Franklin Children's Center down the street. And it's a wonderful, joyous program. We've participated also in the animal sleepover. However, for us, we realized that many of our children did not have a stuffed animal to bring for the sleepover. So with community help, we decided to have a stuffed animal adoption. We had 60 children who adopted a new friend and promised to love and read to them. And for our crafts and special programs, we are very crafty at the Eastside Library. We love having our crafts and families come. We have had over 2,259 children and adults attend so far this year. At the Eastside Library, we also believe in serving our neighborhood and creating community. We love going out into the community. Our community education so far this year, we have made 243 community education site visits, and last year we had 176, and we have yet to promote our summer reading program. We continue to be the primary library for the elementary school Adelante Dual Language Immersion School. Currently, we have 14 Adelante school groups from kindergarten to sixth grade, scheduled to visit the library weekly. This school year, to April, we have had more than 154 Adelante class visits. That is over 3,000 children over 200 adults from Adelante who have visited the East Side Library, and we're not done yet. So that is what I have to share about our fantastic library on the East Side. And I would like to introduce to you Gwen Waggy, Senior Librarian.
Thank you, Maribel. How's that? Okay. Well, this has been an amazing year for the Children's Library. At this time last year, we were in the middle of construction. The library was dusty, it was filled with construction noise, and it was exciting. Every day we could see the new space for our community's children taking shape. We celebrated our grand opening in October or September. We had some special guests there. There were 3,500 people here, or even more than that, I think, all enthusiastically exploring the new space. We couldn't have succeeded without the hard work of all of the library support groups and the generosity of our community's members. The whole building was full of families and activities, and it hasn't been quiet since. Children learn by playing. Our new space invites connection. Families often come to the library for the first time to attend an event or to meet a friend, and when they do, they stay for hours. All of our programs for babies, toddlers, and preschoolers are focused on building early literacy skills. We know that sharing stories, singing, and spending time together all support children as they begin a life of learning. Think about what you heard from the parents in the Baby and Me video. These are the stories that sustain us. We're getting there. Our new space was designed with children of all ages in mind. It is bright and cozy, and staff welcome families warmly. Our library is a place that children look forward to visiting as a part of a weekly routine. We see children grow as they proudly choose stories and activities that appeal to them. Just recently, a little boy walked into the children's area, put his hands on his hips, and said, "This place is all for kids." He could tell. As Jessica said, homework help has evolved into a core service in our library. Attendance has grown phenomenally since we started 2 years ago. Some students visit daily and have built solid relationships with our volunteers and our staff. They even continue to visit the library to read with a partner during vacations. And we saw 30 brand new students just last month. 84% of parents surveyed reported that the homework help program helps their child to perform better in school. And that's the kind of thing that we like to hear. There it goes. This is an after-school care group. The public library is a hub for exploration, discovery, and out-of-school learning. As Jessica also mentioned, we are strategizing new ways to ask questions so that we understand the impact of library programming in our community. I can tell you that in the past year, 77 classes from 19 schools visited the Central Library. Community education staff reached nearly 5,000 children when they told stories in 152 preschool classrooms. And last May, summer reading presentations reached 4,484 students at 13 elementary schools. When we surveyed teachers and parent chaperones, their responses are overwhelmingly positive. They consistently say that they see their children encouraged to read and motivated to explore and visit the library. They assert that their children have gained valuable understanding about the wide variety of free resources that the library offers. We're seeking out new ways to engage students. Youth staff celebrated Dr. Seuss's birthday at 6 schools this spring. By next year, when training and backroom efficiencies that Christina mentioned have been achieved, all staff will have the chance to read to students in their classrooms. The library has also increased our participation in school science nights and family literacy nights. The more connections we have in the community, the more we can highlight and build on our strengths. In preparation for strategic planning, we're focused on growing our library's collaborative partnerships. Our first step was to compile a list of organizations that the library already works with, and it quickly topped 300. We're analyzing how we can boost our reach into the community through asset mapping. We'll use what we learn to inform upcoming decisions about new ways to serve the community. I look forward to next year when we will be telling you all about all the connections we've made to increase programming for seniors and teens by building partnerships. Just one example is that we're entertaining new avenues for collaboration. A local musician and a math director approached us with the idea that launched our first Pi Day event. It brought over 300 people to fill this room with excitement about exploring math and robots. This library was also chosen to host the annual Mayhill Arbuthnot Lecture, which is a national event recognizing a significant contribution to the field of children's literature. This year, bilingual author Pat Mora was honored. She is an eloquent advocate for spreading what she calls book joy. Her exuberance and warmth inspired evening lecture goers at Santa Barbara City College, as well as the families that filled this room again just last weekend to hear her stories. I have two more examples. The library launched a system-wide literacy awareness initiative in February. The foundational principle of 1,000 books before kindergarten is very simple. When children are read to at a very young age, they gain a wealth of vocabulary and literacy skills that prepares them to succeed. They associate reading and learning with cozy interactions. Because of the program, the library was invited to join our local kindergarten readiness network. We're now connected with a collaborative and vision-oriented group of preschool leaders, UCSB education researchers, and the Santa Barbara School District. We can accomplish more for our community by being leaders in discussions with organizations such as this. The library strives to serve people of all ages and educational backgrounds. Our adult literacy program continues to grow. While many learners approach us for help with reading, you may not know that our tutors are prepared to help with GED and citizenship exams, as well as other career training. 95% of learners who set a learning goal to perform their current job better succeeded. In the picture above on the top, you see a group of parents who meet regularly for a book group while their children are working with a homework help volunteer. Last year, 74% of learners who wanted to communicate more effectively with their children's teachers achieved their goal. About two-thirds of them reported feeling more comfortable reading to their children or helping them with homework. Thanks to a statewide partnership, we're excited to offer Leamos, Let's Read, for adults, many of whom have never attended school. In class, these adults learn letters, sounds, and basic reading and writing in Spanish so that they can then learn English. We're also part of a statewide pilot group to test online tutor training. Our dedicated volunteers are constantly seeking new skills that they can use to help their students. All adult literacy learners and tutors keep a journal about their progress. There are currently close to 200 active tutor-learner pairs, and at this time every year, we reflect on and celebrate a year of amazing growth. And now, please welcome back our director, Jessica Cadiente.
Thank you so much. I'm so proud of all the work that our staff has done. And we've talked a lot of tonight, but before we leave, I want to share with you just a short video of a little snippet of the day in the life of our central library. Ruth, please. Thank you. I'm so excited for the future of our community and of our library. And I want to leave you with one last quote. Libraries have the opportunity today to reposition their role in the community, becoming the top-of-mind resource for providing the tools, space, and culture to anticipate and prepare for the needs that will strengthen the communities they serve. This is a defining moment of America's libraries. And with that, that concludes our presentation. We'll open up for questions.
We'll open up for questions.
Okay. We have a microphone. There's a microphone right there if you have a question. Yes, if you could just approach the microphone so that the viewers at home can hear you.
I represent an environmental group that's probably done 100 programs at this library.
Could we get your name?
Wesley Rowe. We've done them over 15 years. So we're one of your big users. We probably hold your largest event here, the Seed Swap, every year, probably 600 people. And what we've noticed, and we've been doing this for a long time, is that it seems to be that local groups are not doing programs here anymore, hardly. The amount of groups doing them has dropped off drastically. We used to, when we first did it 15 years ago, used to take us a couple of months to get a space in this library for a presentation. Now I could just go in any day and just pick the one I wanted. And this is the commons for our community, and it really has dropped away. And I think that is a really important loss, and a lot to do with the economics and more, some to do with the cost of the libraries, because some of the smaller groups can't afford it anymore to make presentations. It costs us probably $500 to put on an event here, because we have to bring our own sound and equipment in, even though the library has some equipment now, and we felt like this equipment would be available to groups. We've loaned out our equipment many times to help groups to have events here because they don't have the video projectors and all those things. And we partner with a lot of groups to make sure that their programs happen here, but we can't do it all the time. Like most small nonprofits, we only have a certain budget for doing events. So I just wanted to bring that up because this is the commons. I know the library is doing a lot of stuff. And also to be able to stream online from here would be really great because it's interesting. The programs we bring here reach out to the world. And Santa Barbara is a special place that way. People look to us for change. And the programs we've brought have brought many changes within our community. And we feel like we really love the library. And last year we nearly left to find other places just because we found it so difficult to be here. So. Said enough, we still appreciate the library and we're still here. So anyway, so thank you all. And thank the board and everybody else for keeping this alive. But I think you should, while all these changes are happening, we also need input from all the different community groups. We have a strong environmental community and it's not appearing here the way it used to. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Back to questions from the board.
Yeah.
Thank you. I have one question. Jessica, you had one slide which said measures of success, and one of the items which was having a seat at the table, I wasn't quite sure if that was covered in the presentation. I wonder if you could.
Having a seat at the table is being a part of the conversation when policymakers are making decisions for our community, that the library is represented there.
And are we? That's what I'm wondering.
That's how we measure success. That is what we are working towards.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
We're working towards.
Milt.
Yes, a couple of questions. There is a mention in the revenue slides of donations and library gifts. What is the difference between those?
Go to your slide that you're looking at. Donations are from friends groups and are general donations. Library gifts are actually big gifts that we count on and have every year. Okay. So an example of that would be, if you've looked in many of our books, they say a gift from Peggy Max in this fund. That is a gift we get every year. And so that would be listed under the library gifts line item.
The FY17 proposed expenses are somewhat greater than the FY16. Are there specific things that are causing the delta?
Salary costs, of course, rise every year, as well as black gold costs rise, and allocated costs charged to us from the city also have risen.
I know that we have been running this year short-staffed.
Yes.
Does this assume that you'll be fully staffed?
Fully staffed in fiscal year 17? Yes.
Thank you.
Could you, in general, tell us a little bit about the strategic plan and where we're at with that?
So the strategic plan is an initiative that will be began in fiscal year 17. So currently we have drafted an RFP that will go out to get a consultant to help guide us through the process. And we're hoping to use some of the salary savings. Our two top positions currently, the two manager positions directly below me, are vacant and have been vacant since September of 2015.
I noticed on the library appropriations that the budget for book acquisitions is going down in fiscal year 17. Can you explain why that you anticipate that?
Over the course of the year, the acquisitions budget has been supplemented by gifts and donations, and we're looking at using some of those funds to help with some of the other initiatives, such as the teen spaces.
Thank you.
Other questions. I just thought I'd wait.
No worries.
You talked about no more paper registration. Can you explain why we have no capacity for paper registration?
So we want to, again, move away from processes that are very staff intensive. And a paper application not only is not environmentally friendly, it also is very time consuming for the customer. They come up to the service desk, you hand them an application, they leave the line, they go fill out the application, they come back. We actually have instituted a 2D barcode scanning process where we use your driver's license and simply scan the driver's license to input the data into our ILS system. So it's just about streamlining practices.
I see. So then my other question is, there seems to be, and I understand the trends in terms of e-books and digital and so on and so forth, but there seems to be a trend towards ignoring, it's not a large segment, there is a small segment of the population that does not have access to cell phones or computers or any of the electronic devices that you're assuming.
What is the question?
Well, the question is, how do you serve them?
We continue to serve all of our patrons. We have technology to varying degrees. We understand that when we talk about emerging technologies, for some people, the library mouse might actually be the emerging technology. But still, if you look at research from Pew Internet Studies and things like that, our kids are on their cell phones. That is the generation that's coming up. And as a library, we need to position ourselves to serve that population.
Oh, I agree, but I'm just kind of saying, but there is still, and maybe we're all going to die off, but there's still a segment who are not.
That's where programs such as our drop-in computer coaching, our appointments for computer coaching, all of those things help. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question.
Yeah, I'm sort of saying, I mean, maybe I'm the last remaining person on Earth, but I don't use a computer at home at all.
Okay, and if you don't want to use a computer or use technology, we have lots of other services, programs, classes, events.
There's lots of analog books in the building.
Yes, we still have a lot of print books.
Okay. I actually do have a question. I noticed in the presentation that sometimes the users of the library were referred to as customers and sometimes as patrons. And I kind of grew up with the patron terminology, mm-hmm. and I'm kind of wondering what the philosophies or thought ways are behind those two terms.
We actually have lots of discussions about that here at the library, and depending on who you talk to, you'll get a different answer. So we kind of purposely threw in different terminology into the presentation to kind of spice things up, but overall, most of our staff are still referring to library users as patrons, mm-hmm. But that is kind of an old hat way of referring to people, so the discussion still lingers.
The IRS has switched to customer, and yeah. I don't know if you want to follow in their footsteps.
Exactly.
But
exactly. We like to call users, but that leaves out all the people who don't use us.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Because we want to get to those people. So,
thank you. Good answer.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to make a suggestion. The city of Santa Barbara has a teen council, a youth council made up of local teens, and I'm sure if you wanted to access one of their meetings or talk to them about what kind of services and space that you're, if you're in development on that, I'd like to offer you the youth council, and Susan Young over in teen programs, I think, would be happy to work with you. I'm working with the East Side librarian. There's a teen that wants to raise money for her East Side library, and so we're trying to create some excitement there. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
I've got two more questions, if I may. One is, lots of great numbers have been thrown around, and one I appreciated was, and when you said 30 new homework help students had attended, and what I was looking for was, is there a differentiation when you say 2,000 X number and so on and so forth? How many of those are repeat walk-in customers as opposed to, so for instance, I come 52 weeks, so I could be counted 50 times. So do you know actually how many are repeat and how many are new and how many are lost? Correct.
We do have statistics for unique users. And what we see is this a balance from the ones that come every week that we've seen since they were, you know, mm-hmm. second graders and now they're fourth graders, and we do see new users as well, or new children.
So it's about, so you're holding steady,
it's,
is what
it's
you're
a balance.
Saying.
I would say it's a balance.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I guess a lot of what we're talking about here is you're trying to upset that balance and increase the new users.
Absolutely, but I do think with that program in particular, we're also supporting children in their growth and keeping them as part of the library.
Mm-hmm.
So okay. Both.
Now I can't remember what my other question was.
Do you want to think about it?
Yeah, go ahead.
Would you like to?
Thank you. I wanted to make a point that the library budget will be reviewed by the City Council on Monday, May 9th. I think that's the right date. And there's a couple of other departments being reviewed in that three-hour time period. So it starts at 3, ends at 6. The library, I think, is the last one. So if you got there at 3:30, you would probably get there in time. Mr. Rowe, maybe you want to bring your concerns to us. Any other library supporters, when the City Council sees the public come to chambers and support the library, support this funding, ask for more funding, ask to double it, just a thought. We love to see people in chambers advocating for the services, the city services that they support. So that's Monday, May 9th, 3 to 6 p.m. in council chambers.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Murillo.
You're welcome.
And one more question.
On slide 7, there's a little inset of ebook users. So I assume those are people who have signed out ebooks.
That is correct.
They're not the number of books signed out, right?
Correct.
Okay. So whereas the other graph is materials that have in fact been borrowed? The graph.
Yes,
on the
all of the colorful graphs represent print collections and the ebook users.
That's a problem. That should have been
use. Okay. So that is the actual number of checkouts.
Ah, okay. So they are comparable charts then.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
I have to say that in my opening remarks, I feel like I completely understated this library. Very impressive. Thank you very much for that. I appreciate that. Board and staff communications. Seeing none. Future agenda items to discuss at this point? Suzette?
Yes, I would like to bring up the concept of, or as our public mentioned, the idea of how we set the price for rental and use of these public rooms. What budget is it in? How do we fix this or change it in some way and come up with some suggestions if we could?
Thank you. Thank you for all attending. Our next regular meeting will be, and this is a change for the group, we've moved to the second Thursday of every month at noon, and we'll be here probably in the West Faulkner Gallery. And with that, can I have a motion to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Discussion? And so moved. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
A closeness we all have earned, a likeness I carry my joy on the left, I carry my pain on